Good morning, everybody. This is the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3, on VoiceEd Radio. I'm Noah Daniel. I am so excited to have Mandy Froehlich here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Mandy passionately encourages educators to create innovative change in their classrooms. Her interest lies in reinvigorating and re-engaging teachers back into their profession, as well as what's needed to support teachers in their pursuit of innovative and divergent thinking and teaching. She consults internationally with school districts and post-secondary institutions in the effective use of technology to support great teaching, mental health support for educators, and how to create organizational change. Her first book, The Fire Within, Lessons from Defeat That Have Ignited a Passion for Learning, discusses mental health awareness for teachers. Her second book, Divergent EDU, is based on an organizational structure she developed to support teachers in innovative and divergent thinking. In addition, Mandy is the director of author success for EduMatch Publishing and co-hosts the BAM Radio Network's Teachers Aid, a podcast discussing social emotional support for teachers. Welcome to the show, Mandy.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I'm so excited. The very first time I started being introduced to you is I had John Harper here on the Personal Playlist Podcast, and he was talking about you and you were co-hosting. And then it was great because I started to see you coming up more and more and learning about your books and starting to read them and really seeing what an amazing impact you had on education so far. And now you partnered with EduMatch and you're the director of author success. How did that come to be?
So it's how I started working with EduMatch is I had pitched one of my books to Sarah and we worked really well together through the process of my books. And when everything was kind of said and done, I said to her, you know, like her and I have very, very different strengths. She's like a big ideas person. She is awesome at coming up with these ideas that are phenomenal. And I'm not so much. I'm kind of a logistical, you know, I see your idea and I raise you how we put it into play, you know?
So that's a good partnership.
Yeah. And so we've had that partnership ever since. And we just kind of fell into those roles. And I cannot say enough about Sarah Thomas. She is the real deal, 1,000%. So I love working with her and then, you know, being able to help authors through their process of writing a book and sharing their message is, you know, just icing on the cake. So
that is a really wonderful thing to do. I know so many educators dream to write a book, and in many ways coming to have that conversation with you and the idea that you're there to support them through the whole process is something really special and different about the EduMatch experience.
Yeah, that's how we felt too. So our, you know, we listened to people who had published with other publishing companies, and we realized that the number one kind of, you know, negative feeling out of those experiences was that they didn't know what was going on all the time. You know, it was sometimes the book was just kind of in limbo for what felt like 3 months or whatever, you know, whatever was going on. And really from the publishing side of it, everybody, you know, in the company is busy. Like they're getting other people's books going, but there was kind of a lack of communication. And in a process where you should be so excited and so happy because you're doing something so phenomenal, we wanted to make sure that throughout the process with EduMatch, people were really feeling supported. And that is definitely one of the areas that differentiates us from other publishing companies. And there are so many fantastic, phenomenal publishing companies out there. And so just from a marketing standpoint, like how do we make ourselves different? And, you know, well, we're going to make ourselves different by doing what we love and what we believe. And that's supporting the authors through the process. So
it's really significant. And I know I went through that process as a children's book author, and there's so much that's out of control. And I think that that's one of the hardest part, especially for teachers, when there's a huge aspect of that in their lives. But that's what's interesting too about the work that you do is your first book that was published deals with mental health. And in many ways, before it became you know, the most prominent conversation, not just for kids, but for teachers. And you were talking about what happens inside the brain, and you were talking about how people could help themselves. And I think that that was something really important in its time. And it's congruent with what you're saying. You're there to support educators in a lot of different ways. And that goes with your podcast as well. Is that something you've always been concerned about, or did that evolve just out of your work?
It actually was, it was kind of an aha moment, honestly. And it happened several years ago in a conversation where I was speaking with somebody about their own childhood traumas. And I had been on a flight. And on my way home, I started thinking about that conversation and how I had spoken about mine, and how I don't want to say it felt good, but it to speak about it. But I was so kind of, I guess maybe it felt good to be able to say those words to somebody with no judgment, I guess, is what I was thinking, because for so long I had held in some of my own traumas and mm-hmm. some of my, you know, my own mental health issues, and hadn't spoken about it because, you know, as I kind of say, like, we work with kids, and teachers are always looked at as that they should be, you know, the strongest person in the room, both emotionally and, you know, and kind of all around. And so it felt good to be able to talk about that. And then I started thinking about, why don't we talk about it? What is it about our profession that we're expected to be these over the top superheroes who have no issues? And I think that in education, we are superheroes in the way that we do good things. You know, we are fighting for the greater good. We're doing those types of things that superheroes do, but we're not superheroes in the way that we're invincible. Like, nobody is. Even Superman has kryptonite, you know? And so it really came out of that whole thought process of, I don't understand why we feel like teachers shouldn't need the same, if not more, support as other professionals, you know, get. And so that's kind of where the conversation started.
But I think it is so significant, and it's that oxygen mask metaphor. Because we are looked to for so many things, we have to take care of ourselves. So it's so important, the work that you do, and it looks holistically at the work that we all do. So one of the things that I like to do when we have the conversation on this show is begin to unpack your three songs. But I like to start with, what was the process like for you of choosing a nostalgic, an identity, and a pick-me-up song as you prepared for the show?
Well, it was definitely an interesting assignment to do. And I love music. I think, you know, music can be so powerful, obviously bring on emotions and make you remember things and kind of heal you in some ways, you know? So I think it was a fantastic thing to need to really sit down and do. But overall, it was actually pretty easy for me. I've had some songs that were just kind of iconic, and I was able to pull them out. There was only one of them that I struggled with just a little bit, but in the end, I'm pretty happy with my choices. So,
oh, I'm so excited. All right, let's dive in. So let's talk a little bit about your nostalgic song, which comes from a rapper from the 1990s. And in many ways, this was like his greatest echelon of fame. And even though we still see him once in a while appearing in reality TV, this is really indicative of a certain time. Why this song and why this era?
Okay, yeah. So that song in particular is Ice Ice Baby by Vanilla Ice. And the reason for that song is actually because there's a story behind it. And the story goes that I had this friend group in middle school, and I wanted so badly. I always felt like kind of the black sheep of the group, just for the simple fact that they had been friends forever. And I was a newer friend for them. And they were very good dancers. They all took dance and things. And I was trying so hard just to fit in with this group. And I adored them. And they were always super, super kind to me. But we had a school talent show. And for the talent show, we decided to do a dance to Ice Ice Baby. And so the dance required me to spend, you know, copious amount of times with these people practicing and doing all these things. And it was so much fun. But it took things for me to a new level being at that age. It was the first time that I ever got on stage in front of people doing stuff when I was incredibly shy. It was the first time that I felt like I was really a part of this friend group that I had, you know, that I had cultivated. And it's one of those times in my educational career that I look back on with like a joyful feeling. And so for many reasons, that song encompasses all of those things that were happening at that time during middle school.
Amazing. So you got up on stage, was it in front of only the middle school or the other people? Well,
it was just the middle school. It was kind of like a middle school talent show. And I can't honestly even remember. I don't think we won anything. I think it was just more just for fun. But
those are pivotal experiences. And what's cool about that is you probably put hours and hours into that dance just for the sake of doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, one of the things that kind of reminds me of is I had just seen Dan Heath keynote, and he's one of the authors of The Power of Moments. And in that book, they talk about peak moments and what is it that makes a moment a peak moment. And it was, you know, that would have been one of my peak moments. It's maybe not something everybody would remember, but there were so many little pieces in play, like kind of so many moving parts at the time, that it was something that I remember. I can even still do most of the dance, actually, because we practiced it so many times.
Well, you can do that while I cue up your song. Here's Ice Ice Baby by Vanilla Ice.
Yo, Vanilla, kick it one time, boy.
Yo, VIP, let's kick it. And listen, I sit back with my brand new invention. Something grabs a hold of me tightly, flow like a harpoon daily and nightly.
Will it ever stop?
Yo, I don't know. Turn off the lights and I'll glow. To the extreme, I rock a mic like a vandal. Light up a stage and wax a chump like a candle. Dance, caress the speaker that booms. I'm killing your brain like a poisonous mushroom. Deadly, when I play a dope melody, anything less than the best is a felony. Love it or leave it, you better gain weight. You better hit bulls out of kid, don't play. If there was a problem, yo, I'll solve it. Check out the hook while my DJ revolves it.
You have it all crystal clear in your mind?
Yep, no doubt.
It's amazing how music can be this whole body experience when you remember something. I appreciate that so much about the nostalgic moments, and people can describe everything in their periphery because they've had this immersive experience. The next song, the identity song, is something that, you know, can change for people. But with this song, I guess it can't really change because in many ways it's the essence of who you are. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah. So my identity song is Mandy by Barry Manilow. And which probably seems pretty obvious, but actually one of the reasons I chose it is because I don't know if you'd be surprised or not, how many people start singing this song to me when they meet me. I like just
really?
All the time. And the funny thing is, and I love this part. You can tell that they all think that they're the only ones that have thought of it, you know, like they get that like really super pleased look on their face. Like,
totally.
I bet you nobody's done this before. And it cracks me up. But when I was in high school, I worked at Walmart. I was a cashier at Walmart. And the number of older gentlemen that would come through my line and start singing that song for me was just insane. And
like
kind of like serenading me in a weird type of way. But the one thing that I kind of learned from that experience was every time they did it, I have never said to anybody, "Oh my gosh, stop! Everybody does that." You know, I've never done that. I've always allowed people to think that they're the only ones who do it. Up until I hear your podcast, and. The funny thing is that when you allow people to just have that moment, it just, you know, it's a very different experience when you interact with somebody, when you allow them to have their moment, than when you kind of crush their spirit with telling them that their idea wasn't good, you know? And it really helped me understand that just who cares if the last 15 people also sang it to you? Let this person sing it. Let them have their moment and let them move on. And it was, you know, the people in it that would do it in Walmart, the gentlemen that would do it in Walmart, they were always so proud of themselves, you know, like big smile on their faces. And
I think it's really good advice. And I think people do that all the time. And yeah.
Yeah.
I know for me, people think that they're like, "Oh, Noah's Ark." And I'm like, "Yeah, thank you."
Are there two of you? Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then I want to say it's NOA. It's a totally different person. But I think it's good advice, Mandy, because those people do get so much joy out of that. So give it to them. Like, how much joy could they possibly, you know, have in their day?
It's right. And what is it? It's certainly not harming me in any way, you know, and. So I did kind of learn that early on, just to sort of watch the people and, you know, there's a kind of a facial transformation that people go through when they're excited about something and they tell you, and you just allow them to be excited versus when they tell you and you squash it with, "Oh yeah, you think the same as everybody else," you know? So it's kind of a story behind that song as well.
Yeah, it takes so little from you and it gives them so much. And especially with Barry Manilow, who's like one of the best singer-songwriters of, well, the 70s for sure. But if you think about all the enduring jingles that this man had, I mean, he is one of the most essential people to know and listen to. So let's listen to your identity song that sings your name, even though the original song was called
Was
Brandy.
It really?
But when Barry Manilow released it, Brandy, You're a Fine Girl was playing, so he changed it to Mandy, and forever it became your song. Here it is. So much of his music has impacted my life. I'm so happy that you brought it here to the show. But this next song, it could be your song too. When I saw it, I thought of your two books and I thought of that imagery you get when you hear you speaking in your enthusiasm. But this song actually came from when somebody else described this artist as this line, she wrote the song that went with it. So why don't you tell us a little bit about this next song, the song that picks you up, lifts you up, inspires or motivates
you? Sure. So that song would be, and there are so, so, so many songs that do this for me, but the one that I chose was Girl on Fire. And And I did choose that kind of for the some of the reasons that you said. We sort of have this running joke now, my friends and I, about the fire within and, you know, what that means. And Sarah often will reference somebody's passion as the fire within. And we just joke about it. But even Divergent EDU, when I went to create its cover, I wanted to make sure that there was an element of fire. And at first I actually was going to go the opposite way. I was going to incorporate an element of water. And I decided no, because fire signifies passion. And that's always what we want in education. And so I decided to do that, but I think that as far as the song goes, just that idea of having a fire kind of lit under me to do the best I can for students and teachers and other, you know, educators, administrators, paraprofessionals, custodians, it doesn't matter who, but making sure that people are loving their jobs as much as I do and all the support that goes along with that. And so that's kind of what I relate back to there. You know, if I forget my fire, well, there it is.
Well, and you fire people up all the time in the work that you do. I mean, Mandy Froehlich, you are on fire and you help to make sure that people can ignite and they can fuel and they can flame that fire in their worlds. And it's amazing. So this is a song I can understand why it picks you up. It motivates all people. I have met so many people who love this song, especially as a woman. So let's play it and get psyched. Girl on Fire by Alicia Keys.
She's just a girl and she's on fire, hotter than a fantasy, lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire, filled with catastrophe, but she knows she can fly away. Oh.
Learn so much about people in the music that they listen to, and then to have them go even further and identify with that music, that's amazing. I love it.
Oh, I'm so happy that you enjoyed the process and that you enjoyed sharing it. Where can people find you?
So you can find me at Froehlich M, which is Froehlichm. Everybody misses that first H. Also, mandyfroehlich.com. You can find me as well. And, or you can find, my work on the Teacher's Aid podcast, which is on the BAM radio network, with John Harper, obviously. So any of those places, are great places to find me.
Wonderful. I want to thank you so much. I know you're so busy, but I really appreciate the time coming on the show and telling your story through your three songs. I wish you continued fire and igniting of passions across education. Do you have anything you want to add before I play you out?
No, just thank you so much for having me. This was an absolute blast. I'm happy to be here.
Okay. I hope you have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist Podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.